Thank you all for coming out. I know HGTV would have been a lot more fun this morning. I'm Brice Creelman from Shades of Green in Frisco, Texas. Anybody been there? Okay, thank you. I'll give you a little background because I was born and raised in New York State, so I am a Yankee. I was born and raised on an estate in New York, so we had a big greenhouse. And I think that's where I became involved with plants. You know, we had a lemon tree in there and orchids. But when I came down here, I found a nursery and they had a tractor. Since a farm boy, I knew I could work there. So I came down here in 77 and started working at North Haven Gardens down in Dallas. And the owner, Ralph Pincus, was a true plantsman. They'd been here since the 50s, and he kind of took me under his wing, and I learned propagation from him, which is cutting and starting new plants, division or cuttings. So I learned plants that way, and that's a great way to learn it. Even in your own yard, if you divide anything or have tried cuttings, it's a great way to kind of learn it. Everything we're going to talk about is kind of opening your mind up to native plants. Everything I talk about today can take once a week watering. That's what we're going to talk about, these perennials. Most of them are native to Texas. The ones that are native to West Texas, of course, will live here on natural rainfall. If you're watering twice a month, that's 24 times a year. Take out the 3 months of November, December, January. My math is bad today, that's 3 times 2. It gets down to very few times you're watering your yard. We put a lot of energy into this green lawn and watering, but it really shouldn't amount to more than as much as you go to Target. No, that doesn't work either. But anyhow, I went to Puckett's this morning before I came here and to make sure they had native plants, which I knew they do. They're friends of ours and we work with them. But this plant was there. This is a Salvia greggii at Puckett's. And Puckett's gave me the plant to the city of Allen today. So we'll raffle all these plants off with that one too. This is a big, big deal. So I'm going to try and make it really quick. When you're out in your lawn, here's what you got to know what's going on in your landscape is we have alkaline soil. Now I've never really thought much about a soil test. When I think A&M or the Master Gardener say test your soil, I really would say you should do that because although it's more than likely going to be alkaline, it gets it in your head that it's alkaline. Now that's the biggest deal about landscaping in Allen, Texas, is we have alkaline soil. Has anybody checked their soil and it's not alkaline? It pretty much is. This part of Texas is all alkaline soil. Up north now, Shades of Green, we have a growing operation that is up in Clark's Outpost, Texas. Everybody know where that is? Clark's Barbecue? Yeah, I didn't think anyone knew where Tioga was, so I've been using Clark's Barbecue. But anyhow, it's a small town north and west of here. We started a tree farm for Shades of Green because we really had trouble finding trees that would really adapt to this soil. So we started growing them in this soil. But up there, there's some real loamy soil that's almost acidic. So they got a lot of blueberry farms in East Texas, but also in North Texas now. But ultimately, you have alkaline clay soil. The plants that grow in that grow real good. Now, this is really productive soil. They've been farming in it for years. It holds a lot of moisture. The issue is it's either really dry or it's really wet. Whenever you're out in your landscape doing something, just remember compost. I would say bark mulch also, but that really, when you're digging a hole and planting any of these plants, you're talking about trying to get that soil out and just mix it with some compost so you can get it back in the hole. What happens is a lot of times it comes out the clump of the shovel is what you're working with. As you put compost in your beds, you'll notice that about the third year you have like soil that's, anybody here not from Allen? Okay, it makes it better because you know usually in other parts of the country there's like soil you can work with. You can almost dig with your hand, quite honestly. But what happens is in other parts of the country there's alkaline and acid soil, but there's also friable soil, which means, you know, it's just kind of nice without any components in it. I think we have to at least do some compost, and that works best. Anything else you want to use, whether you use green sand, we're not going to get into that today because it's too much. We're just going to talk about basic stuff, and that is this soil, you're not going to change it. A plant that doesn't grow in this soil ain't going to grow in this soil. You've learned that the hard way. We've all learned that the hard way. The thing is, when you buy a plant, it doesn't say anything about soil. It may have a zone on it, which ultimately I don't care about. Coldness zone, we're a zone 7A or B. That's really a winter zone. Can it get through minus 10 degrees? That isn't the issue. The issue is getting through August. You're talking about summer hardiness here, not winter hardiness. Who cares about winter hardiness? For the most part, if a plant comes back, you should be happy. Most people that have gardened in the last 10 years come in and say, oh my God, that plant came back. I can't believe it. Yeah, that's what's supposed to happen. I think people are used to buying a plant, it's flowering, and then it dies for whatever reason. These plants will thrive on neglect more or less. And it changes your whole yard because you're really out in it. When we started, and this is new to me too, believe me, working with Ralph Pincus at North Haven, I was brought up on Japanese maples from Japan, hostas from China, plants from all over the world was his deal. He didn't even care about native plants. When we first started, it was like everything else. It's just the junky little plants, you know. So I've been working with them for 30 years. And it's amazing when people turn to it and start using them, how much more they want to be in their yard and how much everything else changes. And the misconceptions is what's so big and what we'll try and work on today. Anybody have any questions before we keep going? Okay. So we want to say that we have alkaline soil that holds moisture. Most of the plants that you want to go in, these plants will work better if you don't have an irrigation system. Now that's drastic, but quite honestly, I live in the country. I live in Van Alstine and I don't have a sprinkler system. And anybody that's in the country doesn't, they still have landscapes going on. The other issue is when you move to Allen, I don't think anybody tells you about irrigation system. Is that true? You just kind of want to fiddle with it to see how it works? That's another issue, and that I don't understand them either. Quite, I have an irrigation system at work that I'm still fiddling with, but for the most part, you've got to start thinking that you're going to water, let's use once a week. What that means is in your yard, if you have plants there that died, or you think you're going to kill them because you don't water them four times a week, let them go. Because honestly, this isn't something we're just trying to get through. This is the future. So we're all forward thinking here. Number one, if you're going to a garden center, you got to be really careful. There's plants that you can buy that don't grow here. And you've all learned that. Maybe, maybe not. It's not your fault. When the azalea dies, it's not your fault. Azaleas don't belong here. Azaleas are our best-selling plant in Dallas-Fort Worth. Now, how do you make sense of that? It's the best-selling plant, yet it will not grow here.
That's a lot of work.
It's a lot of work. Now, they can grow here, and when I started, we've sold azaleas and always said, well, you know, all you got to do is just dig out the native soil down about 18 inches and replace it with a peat compost mix and plant the azaleas. You know, if you start thinking about what you're saying, it just doesn't make sense anymore. There's azaleas down in Highland Park that are gorgeous. They work at it. They're rich enough to have them. You're not rich enough to have them. I'm not going to fight the fight with Highland Park. I'd love to go down there and see it, but honestly, that's fine. They're going to have them. They're rich. They can have them. Rich people have a lot more stuff than we do. So that's where you go and enjoy them. Also, as far as soils go, from Dallas down to Houston. Houston is the piney woods. That's East Texas, so there's lots of azaleas in Houston. They should be there. The soil is acidic. When you go east of here to Tyler, the soil is acidic, so you'll find azaleas, camellias, gardenias, hydrangeas, all that stuff. Southern Living Magazine, right there. Southern Living Magazine, ain't doing you nothing here. Except looking at the pretty pictures. There's no magazine that can help you with gardening except a Texas-based magazine. When you live here and garden here, it's very specific to this area. If you follow Neil Sperry or Howard Gehr, whoever it is, follow somebody from Texas first, and then use your nuances to go either way. Neil Sperry, you know, we think we're bringing him around slow but sure, but I'm not so sure. He still has an azalea, you know, Encore Azalea ad in his magazine. Great slick magazine, and it's about Texas, but you know, he's not coming around. Howard Garrett, you know, we've worked with him, but he was way over the other way for a long time. I'm starting to see that now. I'm understanding it's really hard to be on the fence with this stuff. And that means, even in your life, if you're changing how you eat, you know, if you want whole foods or something different, after a while you start making these changes that, you know, hamburger helper isn't in your house. It just can't fit there, you know. And gardening's the same way. After a while, you gotta let loose of that stuff. And it's a hard, it's a tough love kind of thing. And it happened this year because this was what happens every 10 years. We can have really cold where it'll kill stuff or really hot and dry where it'll kill stuff. But there's a lot of landscapes that look great. You know, how did it happen? I think a lot of people panicked when they shut off their sprinkler, and we use 7-Eleven as an example. The 7-Eleven company, for some reason, when it gets hot and dry, all their shrubs just die. You know, they just shut off the system, you know, either to save money or not knowing better. They just go opposite way. You still got to water plants, you know, but you can hand water almost any time under any restrictions. What we're talking about is the soil. You're going to feed the soil, not the plant. You get the right plant in. It's really ultimately going towards, if you use native and adapted plants, and I use adapted plants, I love crepe myrtles, you know, I'm not on it. And we can talk about that if you have a question about what is adapted and what is native or not adaptable. We'll talk about that. But what happens is all those plants work here. Crepe myrtles work here. To some extent, a lot of roses work here. There's tons of plants that do that. You don't have to go completely to this, but sometimes it's easier to talk about what doesn't grow here because there's really a short list. And it's azaleas that everybody has. It's probably gardenias that everybody loves. Hydrangeas. There's one that's native to East Texas, oak leaf hydrangea, that does pretty good, but otherwise, you know, again, they just don't grow here. No matter what anybody tells you how much they can change the soil, what's happening is we're talking about sustainability. I'd like to use that word more than native, because really it means you're leaving Allen the same or better than when you came here. That's really what that means. So that's putting a lot of plants that are native here or take very little care. When you start using native plants, I grow 5 greenhouses full of these 1-gallon type plants. My spray program is a squirt bottle, a liter squirt bottle that I have bioneem in or something, in case there's aphids or something comes in with it. When you start growing these plants, there are no insect and disease problems. So the whole chemical on your lawn is out the door. There's nothing, none of these native plants need a chemical spray or fertilizer. If you move your lawn towards native and adapted plants, you get rid of somebody taking care of your, well, you don't get rid of somebody taking care of your, but you get rid of worrying about spraying or diseases or insects or something that didn't go right. Overwatering is the biggest issue. This past year, when people couldn't water, they were coming in and saying, God, my landscape really looks great. Because it's true, a lot of these plants will do better with less water. Trees like, anybody know what desert willow is?
Yes.
The big shrub? All of a sudden, it was blooming almost all season long, like it's supposed to, because it didn't get watered. And again, you know, when you're hot working outside and you see a plant that has a big leaf and it's wilted over, you say, gosh, that needs some water, same as me. You know, it just isn't true. There's no native plants that have a really big leaf on them. Because they can't. They mostly, like a yaupon holly has a real small leaf on it. They can get through it. The smaller leaf, the better. The grayer leaf, the drier the plant. When you're going out to exchange, now I'm saying that, go out and buy new plants. How are you gonna do that? Number one, you can use any of these. Number two, a garden center like Puckett's is thinking that way. They have 2 benches full of a lot of perennials that are all drought tolerant. some native, some not, but mostly I would agree with everything they got there. Shades of green is another one. We took all the bad choices out of the garden center. We don't sell azaleas, haven't sold them for 10 years. We just don't do it. And when people come in and say, you know, you got any encore azaleas, like, no, we don't sell them. Well, you know, then you're at a point, what are you going to do with that? Because either you got to explain it all, or they can say, just go down to someplace and get them. If they're interested in knowing or didn't know that when they bought them that there was going to be a problem, we'll work with them. But there's a website called Texas Smartscape that's Master Gardener, or no, Master Gardeners really haven't put it together. It was done by local people. I know one is Randy Weston of Weston Gardens, and other people like Gail could have been part of it. I don't know if you were or not, but right, and that's a good starting list. I don't know if I agree with all those plants, but I don't want to split hairs on it, because to get started that way means you got to start looking for those plants. If you're going to shop at Home Depot or Lowe's, start taking those lists with you. Quite honestly, you can shop there, but you got to know enough to shop there. The problem is I can shop at Home Depot, and when you start knowing it, you can too. But if you just move to this area and go to Home Depot and get your plants, you're going to get where you head in Ohio. And that's not going to work. Because why? We have alkaline soil. Let's just start it that way. It sounds better. No plant tag is going to have that on there. Most plant tags say sun to part shade, fertile, well-drained soil. Every plant tag probably says that. So, you know, that's the issue with it, is you're starting that way. And we don't have fertile, well-drained soil. We got clay soil that doesn't drain very well unless you add some compost to it. As far as saying if you're putting in a new bed or changing something, I don't want you to go out and make a raised bed and spend hundreds of dollars putting in all kinds of soil amendments. Now, if you want to go organic and say I'm going to put in some green sand, molasses, whatever else you put in it, that's fine. But these plants that we're going to talk about today will grow in this native soil with compost. I'm getting to the point where we're saying, as far as fertilizer goes, pretty soon it's going to be non-existent. You will not have to fertilize. Odd sounding, isn't it? But when you start using native and adapted plants, anybody know the Earthkind program? Okay, that's kind of Texas A&M, so it's a rough spot for them, because they're starting to say things that they never said before. Which means if you put out an Earthkind rose, which is just these roses they put out and trialed, and said, oh my gosh, Belinda's Dream is a gorgeous rose. It's pink, it's full, it's fragrant, grows 4 to 6 foot, just a gorgeous rose, grows in this soil, in this part of Texas, with no problems. There's no black spot, there's no issues with anything. Roses is a good example. I think everybody likes roses. You can grow roses in Texas. When looking back, what happened when they were saying, geez, how do you grow roses in Texas? Let's go ask the rose experts. Well, the rose experts were the people that did roses for show. So their roses were hybrid, that they wanted long stem, perfect roses. That's what they wanted. That's how they grew roses. And it's the opposite of how you're going to grow roses. They would say, well, you need to put out a hybrid tea, put a lot of sand in there or peat, and cut it back to the third, you cut it back to some idiotic place that's going to make a difference when it doesn't. You can have any rose, you can cut it back with a shear, and all of them will do fine. The new roses, the shrub roses, even better. What's gotten us in a good and bad place is knockout rose. You know, there's a shrub, that's a shrub landscape rose. It's a flowering shrub. It's not even a rose to me. It has no fragrance, kind of like a rose, but it really is a flowering shrub. And it works great that way. Now, we've taken advantage of knockout roses, for gosh sakes. We've certainly planted them. And now we find out that maybe they weren't that 3 to 4 foot rose. They really get about 4 to 5 foot. Anybody seen them bigger than that in their house? 5 to 6 foot. And again, that shows that they may be in good soil, but quite honestly, they would grow that way in this soil, in this native soil.
And I never see them.
A matter of fact, if you start putting plants in native soil and don't use Miracle-Gro on them all the time, they'll grow just fine. And really, let me pick on Miracle-Gro. Anybody use it in their landscape, Miracle-Gro? Sure you do. You don't have to raise your hand. But don't. Stop doing it. Now, Miracle-Gro, the only time I'd use any kind of liquid fertilizer that had mixed with water is if I had a big pot with a soilless mix, which means if you have any planters on your patio, more or less you've gotten a bag mix to put in it, you really can't use native soil in a big pot because it ain't going to drain off that well. So almost always use some kind of good quality bag mix for those containers. At that point, there's nothing in there. It's all kind of inert ingredients. Nothing's breaking down. So at that point, if you use Osmocote, if you go organic or non-organic, it doesn't matter because you got that little pot. When you plant those up this time of year, they really do fine. As it gets hot, the roots go out to the edge and they dry out every day. So enjoy them in the spring, and when it starts getting too much, toss them out. If you put plants in there that can live in the landscape, transplant them into your yard. If you use this is stipa, Mexican feathergrass. You know, this works great in containers. Anybody use this in containers? You know, it works great, but if it starts getting in a container that's dry, this plant will thrive, but if it gets bad, just plant it in the ground. But anyway, that's the only time I would use Miracle-Gro. When you're talking about your lawn, I'm not talking about lawns, by the way. Don't ask me a question about your lawn because I don't care. We haven't got time. But anyhow, when you're talking about that, you're talking about, I have to go out and fertilize my lawn. Well, you fertilize it, and then we rain, it starts growing, so you got to mow. Well, you're mowing every week because you're fertilizing four times a year. Where's the sense in that? You know, the lawn, usually my lawn in the country, I just mow it. That's the program. There's no fertilizer involved. There's no water involved. It's just mowing it. Right now, if you have a lot of weeds in it, mow them down. Keep mowing them. They'll be gone. A lot of weeds that come out now in the spring are cool season weeds, and they're gone on their own. Henbane, the purplish one. You know, sometimes it's that's a gorgeous ground cover. That's what you thrive to get, is a ground cover like that. But yet we think it's a weed. I do too. Dandelion's the same way. You know, possibly you or your parents, when the dandelions came out, they were out there cussing and swearing. You know, the dandelions aren't bad. They're out there blooming. What are you going to fight that the rest of your life? For what? We used to sell a lot of golden euonymus. You know what that is? In Dallas, when I came in the 77 to the 80s, it was growing so crazy, there's no way local growers could keep up with the demand of plants, so we brought in truckloads from California. I mean, just truckloads of whatever they had out there. We didn't say, "Oh, don't give me euonymus." We didn't know anything. We sold euonymus and dicistox to take care of it. You know, it's going to get scale, so put this on it. You know, it was asinine looking back on it. That probably still goes on. There's no way that you should use golden euonymus. It's not an adapted plant. There's one euonymus that's native to this area. We're not going to get into today, but for the most part, euonymus comes here. If it's out of its element, it's stressed. And when plants get stressed, they get disease or they die. And golden euonymus is another good example of a plant that is almost made with scale on it. Scale is that little white stuff on the underside of the leaves that gets on it, and then it gets on the stems, and then it's just gone. If you really think you have to save that golden euonymus by spraying with something, that's wrong. It's not supposed to be here, so just get rid of the plant and put in something that's native. That will never have to be sprayed or gets any pests that make any difference. Most of the pests on native plants are what we like. You know, the caterpillars that are eating it are turning into butterflies. If there's aphids on your plant, it's not going to be the last thing in the world. The neighbors aren't going to talk about you. Aphids are okay. Aphids are usually on plants that are pushed with a high nitrogen fertilizer, like Miracle-Gro. Miracle-Gro makes plants grow. When they get that new fleshy growth, aphids love that new fleshy growth, so they'll be on there all the time. When you cut back on your fertilizing and your water and just let a plant be, it's okay just to let the plant be in your yard. You don't have any of these issues with any insects or diseases. All that stuff's gone. As far as how we're trying to do it organically, that's a big stretch for a lot of people, and we struggle with it too. We're learning as we go at Shades of Green or anybody else that's talking about it. Howard Garrett's another one that through the years has changed his ideas. corn gluten meal as a weed killer, also as a fertilizer, natural fertilizer. I think he's backed off that to where, you know, it's just too hard to find the right time to put that out. If people are doing it and happy with it, good for you, do it. But a lot of newer people, it's like, well, you got to have a real dry time, and then you put it out, and then hope it rains, and then it gets hot again, and then it's going to work. But this year, you know, when the lob plants didn't even go dormant, I mean, our lowest temperature was probably 28. Anybody keep track of that? What was the lowest in Allen? Probably in the upper 20s. So a lot of stuff didn't even go dormant. Maybe you got begonias that are still blooming.
I still have begonias.
So a lot of insects that are on the plants from last year when they were stressed from being, you know, no rain for a couple of years, may still be on there, you know. So that'll be rough, but that new plant will send out growth. Don't be afraid to cut back plants in your yard. There's nothing that you're going to cut back that's going to die. Everything has an exception. Everything I talk about is an asterisk with it. Because when I go to Plano, there's a street down there that has this white dogwood. Dogwood's another acid-loving plant, not for Dallas-Fort Worth. But there's one growing in Plano in the front yard in full sun and doing great. I can't explain it. They don't. It's just lawn all around. It's not like they do anything. It's just, you know, there's dogwoods growing down in Dogwood Canyon. A new Audubon Park that's south of Dallas, Dogwood Canyon. There's dogwoods growing down there on this rock in the woods. It's the opposite of what should be going on. Dogwoods don't grow here. Well, listen, you've been in plants long enough that, you know, dogwoods might. Impatience used to be for shade. Right. Impatience were for shade. Well, now there's sun impatience. So, you know, it's very confusing. Don't feel bad when you go to garden center. It's confusing, and it is for us too. Coleus used to be a shade plant. Now there's sun coleus. They grow in sun or shade. What's up with that? Annuals are plants that you would put out that'll die at the first frost. So you get season-long color. Perennials come back year after year. As we're working with both of those plants, a lot of annuals are getting hardier where they're not dying every year. There's one called Angelonia. Does anybody know that? There's a couple of those that come back. So there's some annuals that are perennial. And there's some perennials that we want to sell at the same time as annuals, because that's when you're in the garden center. You're in the garden center in April. No matter what we say about fall is for planting, you are in the garden center in April, or starting yesterday because we were real busy. But anyhow, it's nice right now. You're going to go out and do everything in April. You're going to cut everything back. You're going to week everything out. You're going to replant. So when you go to the garden center, whatever looks good that day, that's what you're going to plant. That could work or not. That's another thing that's just too big. But anyhow, know that we want perennials that are blooming. The earlier they bloom, the more you'll take them. There's perennials here that don't even start blooming until June and then go through till November. Who's going to pick up a skullcap now? It's just a small little plant. It has no flowers on it. So like we say, you gotta visit your local independent garden center 5-6 times a year at least through the seasons. You don't have to buy anything. You just got to go see what's going on. It's amazing what's going on in August in the garden center. We have rain lilies blooming for the first time. Plants that just coming in their own, like coneflower, purple coneflower. Purple coneflower is native to Texas, but it's a real tough plant to grow. Another one don't feel bad about. Anybody have real good stand-up purple coneflower? Very good. If it gets in the spot at once and you got the water right in the soil, it can thrive. The newer coneflowers that are all different colors, we've trialed them and can't find one that really does anything here. You're really looking at growing purple coneflower. Echinacea purpurea. Echinacea purpurea is purple coneflower, our native purple. There's two or three native coneflowers, but again, even just because it's native to Texas doesn't mean it's fail-proof. Texas is four states. Could be more, but let's say it's four. So where that plant comes from, you're talking about native plants to Collin County. Our palate ain't so good. There's Farran salvias and a couple things, but ultimately, I still like something a little more ornamental. So a lot of plants in West Texas I really like. Blackfoot daisy, you know, you're talking West Texas, Central Texas. So you're talking rainfall, Beaumont, Texas, down in that southeast corner. I think 50 to 55 inches of rain a year. Way out West Texas, you're probably talking 7 inches of the year. Here, you're talking 30, 35. As a landscape couple, we plant landscapes all year long. We stop doing big B&B trees in the summer just because everybody tends to say, I'll water it, and then they're going to on vacation for a couple weeks. But for the most part, fall is for planting, but between you and I and a wink, everybody's gonna do it in April. That's when everything's blooming. If you go to buy a plant and you don't, you wanna know what it looks like, maybe. And that's where that comes from, is you won't buy a plant unless it's blooming. But you don't have to do that with a lot of native stuff. You're gonna have to buy them green and small in a pot, as a matter of fact. But they will thrive in your landscape. Whether you go to the garden center and bring back this and your neighbors, the pressure from your neighbors or your family, like, God, you paid $8.99 for that? What, are you crazy? But you know, this plant, you put it out in the landscape, and it's gonna be 3 foot tall by 3 foot across by the end of the season, and blooming all that season. This is pink skullcap. Now for you purists, this is from Mexico, but we can see it from here, so it works as a native for us. And it's just a gorgeous plant. Fall is for planting. We get a lot of rains. It's cooler out. Quite honestly, when can you work in your yard in Texas? You got the next maybe 6 or 8 weekends, and then you don't. It's just too hot. When people come here from, they just move here in July, and they're coming in looking for some geraniums, or you're like, you know, where do you start? You shouldn't even, you know, what are you doing out trying to garden? You know, so you learn that the earlier the better. If you can find plants at a plant sale or something early, or a garden center, get them early. All you're buying are the roots. In these native plants, you're really just buying the root system that you're going to get in the ground, let it get established. All native plants have a seriously deep root system. Anybody that's tried to dig out a lot of big old native plants know that taproot just goes down to water. Desert willow's one that we have a hard time growing in the field and transplant because we can't get enough of that taproot. Eve's necklace, there's a lot of certain plants that just have this huge taproot. Sable minor. What's the palm that's Texas palm sago. That's sable palm?
Sago.
No, not the sago. The sable palm sable is the native one. That, you know, people say I'm going to the woods and dig it. They stop after a while because they have this. And the oaks the same way. Any trees that are native to here, huge root system. Encore azaleas have a very fibrous, shallow root system. So even if you plant them, the issue is you can't get them enough water because they usually grow in peat moss or a mix like that where they have this, you know, the roots are just small little fibers. There's no taproot. They just go along the top of the ground. So that's why you have to water them. The issue is if we stay at some kind of restriction in watering, restriction, that's a bad word, that the azaleas will die on their own. I don't think they're going to make it with that. Without supplemental watering. If you think it's that important to have azaleas, well, you know what, I'm not gonna be able to change it, I don't think, today. But anyhow, that'll be one of those things that you'll have to start looking at. Well, now the issue with that is I got a lot of shade in my yard, and Allen used to be full sun. Back in 1980 when they built this town, it was full sun town. They didn't care about shade plants. They didn't have any shade except the north side of the house. So everything was sun. Now, a lot of these canopies have grown. Those live oaks grew, didn't they? Bradford pears, everything grew. And now you got shade, you can't even grow anything under. Let's talk about that because that's a big deal. Let's talk about the shade in your yard. If you have full sun, I understand it. If you say you got shade, it's tough. Because you say, well, it's kind of, you know, sun, then shade, 2 hours, this and that, it's dappled, east side, you know, it's just tons of shade. A lot of sun perennials will work in a little bit of shade. When I say full sun for Salvia greggii, this plant from Puckett's, if it gets a little shade in the afternoon, it's kind of happy with that, quite honestly, if it has shade from 3 o'clock on. Almost every plant will be happy in Texas because we have this long day, this full sun. What the heck? I mean, you got 12 months of growing season. If you came from Ohio, your gardening season started Memorial Day and it ended Labor Day. It's like 3 or 4 months. You planted everything, a pansy, a petunia, a geranium, the ground guard, everything happened. And then everything, it was too cold. Here, you gotta get through 12 months. So even if you use a plant that was up north, It's going to struggle here from that one thing. That how's it going to stay alive for 10 months? Hosta is a good example. Anybody have hostas or no hosta plant for shade? They just get tired out. And believe me, at North Haven Gardens, we had 250 varieties of hostas trying to find ones that would work here. I was getting paid, it didn't matter much to me, but the owner loved hostas. And we'd just get them in from all over the country, and we'd put them in there and watch them grow. And June 1st, we'd watch them all die. It's just one of those plants that just tires out. Now, it can go dormant. If you don't overwater it, the next thing is going to be letting your plants go dormant, which is going to be fine. A lot of natives go dormant, which means they'd shut down. The foliage is gone. The roots are there growing. The tops are gone. Yeah, my yard's going to look like crap. There's that word. Botanical term is crap. That's something else for another time. Which means we were someplace where we're talking about shade. We're talking about hostas. Okay, we're talking about shade. Hostas will grow here if you don't water them three times a week. They come from China, probably the same place in China that has the same soil we do. And crepe myrtles come from China where there's alkaline soil. So when you get these plants from China, they work here. Crepe myrtle, I think, is a great plant. I think it's adapted. The issues with, if anybody have scale on it the last couple years, or know what scale is?
Yeah.
You know, I think crepe myrtles are just stressed now. We have a lot of crepe myrtles, the same as we have a lot of knockout roses. These are other issues. But the crepe myrtles, for the most part, are fine. And they'll take it really dry or really wet and still do it. You do not have to cut your crepe myrtle back, but if you've been doing it and your dad did it and your mama did it and your grandma, then you're going to keep doing it, but you don't have to do it. It's not, the only issue is because the crepe myrtle was planted right next to your house and it's up under the eaves, it's just planted in the wrong spot and you got to keep cutting it back. When you get older and sick of doing that, then you got to cut it out completely. If you take a crepe myrtle and cut it back to the ground, you know it'll come back up and you'll gain yourself a couple years. You can make a new crepe myrtle. But crepe myrtles come from 30 inches. There's a crepe myrtle called Pocomoke that the US government introduced called Pocomoke. It's 30 inches tall and blooms, a little globe, little green meatball, and then it grows 30 inches tall. Or crepe myrtles will get 25 feet. So when you're buying crepe myrtles, ultimately, when you're buying plants, you've got to smarten up. Don't let the people at the garden center tell you anything. A lot of garden centers don't have the palette you're supposed to work with, nor can those people help you. And I'm making big grand statements here, but this is a tough love today, so we'll do it. Because that's really the whole issue of how you landscape, and what happened right there when you went out and said, let's go get some plants. Well, you know, shades of green's kind of high. Let's go over here. They got something on sale. So, that, you know, you can go there and get it on sale. You take a lot of plants. Again, most people got bummed out that their landscape, after all this money, the stuff died. And that was because it was the wrong plant. Because we have what kind of soil?
Alkaline.
Right. We're going to remember this by, we're going to look at a state Texas map. And from, we say Tyler, but really it's Edgewood. Anyone know where Edgewood, Texas is? Out there between. That's where the soil changes. You're driving out Interstate 20 to East Texas to the casino someplace. When you get to Edgewood, you start seeing dogwoods, pine trees, sweet gums. These are all acid-loving stuff. Edgewood, that's where, if you draw a line from Edgewood down to Houston, we're the alkies, they're the asses. We're the alkies, alkaline soil, they're the acid soil. We won't say acids, we'll say acids. And when you're looking for plants, that's where you got to go. Plant lists for this area, which is Smartscape, Master Gardeners, Native Plant Society. Anybody that has a plant list is going to be mostly alkaline soil first. Azaleas are not on anybody's recommended planting list. Isn't that odd? How do you all learn about plants that, you know, you don't? You just go and it looks good. Or if you say, we got shade, I want some color in the shade. What am I going to do? I got shade, I want color. Well, here's some encore azaleas. We used to say, well, yeah, but you got to do a lot of soil prep to get those to work. I don't think that's said anymore from what people tell me. Anybody here a master gardener? Their list is a little dated also, but they're coming around quickly. And this, up in Myers Park, they have that perennial bed. We gave them 180 perennials to find out what does good here. Well, I already knew that because a lot of them were native. And if you're looking for a Texas superstar plant or a plant that, you know, does this or that, it's got to be native first. And there's a lot of plants up there that are not native, but ultimately, a year like last year that was when it gets so cold, a lot of native plants also go dormant, which means if it's real cold, they don't care, they're down in the ground. And if it gets real dry, they'll go dormant, but they will come back. When we're talking about native plants and gardening, it's a real good lazy way to garden. There's no issues you have with these plants. There's no special needs that you got to cover them up or you need a special fertilizer. There's no plant that you'll plant here that needs a special fertilizer. Save your money, buy some Doritos and Dr. Pepper. There's no reason you need any special fertilizer. Asterisk, okay, I know everybody has a little rose or something, they've always put something on, that's fine. If it's working for you, do it. But don't go out and buy a new plant and buy a fertilizer for that plant. You cannot go home and have encore azaleas, impatiens, begonias, I hate to pick on, but they probably make it through the summer pretty good. They're okay. You can't have those plants. You can't have them anymore. It just ain't going to work. So that's why this plant pal is going to take work on your part. That you came today, the city thanks you, I thank you. It's a start. Your neighbors, people come in all the time to the garden center, say, my neighbor sent me here. What your neighbor's doing, that's the new pro in town, whatever the heck that neighbor's doing, because, you know, they're it. So if you got a lot of pressure from your neighbor, they're doing something right, see what they're doing. I doubt they're watering four times a week and out there working their butt off trying to keep it green. Because the more you water, the more you fertilize, the more you gotta do maintenance. The more you water, the more you fertilize, the more you gotta maintain. So if somebody else is doing that for you, they're going to do it the easiest way. They're going to put everything in a little green meatball, cut everything back to the ground, cut the crepe, and they're going to charge you all year long to do it. You could do it. You don't have to do any of that. You don't have to cut your crepe myrtles back. Shrubbery you have to cut back once a year probably, but again, when you use native and adapted shrubs, they're not growing like crazy. Eleagnus, anybody know what Eleagnus is? Silver leaf plant. That mostly builders would put in front of a house because it grows fast, so it looks good quick. When that becomes your problem, you're cutting it every month. It just grows like crazy. You know, sends out these long runners with the silver leaves. You know, you want to get past that. And as I get older, that's why I can buy into this, because as you get older, no offense to anybody in the room, but as you get older, it's a little tougher working out there every weekend. You want to work out there because you're going to see plants blooming for the first time. When you use native plants and put in a whole border of these plants, that's a border right there. That's 16 feet. That's a little too close. When you're talking about this size plant, 3 foot. Look at it as 3 foot apart and they'll fill in. Now you're going to plant them too close, the same as I do. That's fine. You can move them during this time of year. You can move plants between Thanksgiving and Valentine's Day. If you want to transplant or divide, somebody says about dividing plants with your neighbors, perfect. If you got iris or something that's getting too big, artichoke, Jerusalem artichoke, did you say? Jerusalem sage. All those plants, the native plants are going to thrive and come back year after year. And they'll multiply, so you can share them with your neighbor. That's how to do it. If that's native or not, I don't care. If it's alive and you're doing it, it's probably doable. The thing that we're learning is the if anybody knows about perennials, I think they've always been bigger in other parts of the country than they are here. It's really tough to pigeonhole some of the plants we have as their perennial annual, or I want a shrub. These are shrubs. I'm calling them perennial because that's how we got to sell them. I can't sell them as a shrub in a gallon. These are almost all shrubs. They may not be evergreen, but they're going to be there in some form. You do not have to have an evergreen yard. You're in Dallas, Texas. So this whole thing about maintenance, yeah, that is a deal. And when you got native plants, honestly, I'm still saying when I go out in my yard back and I use Valentine's Day is when you're out there, stuff's starting to grow. Weed whacker across the whole thing, all these plants. If they're there up, because there's a new crown, there's new growth coming at the bottom, that's your new plant. Cut off all that dead stuff, cut it hard. When we have pruning classes at the nursery, people gasp, they almost faint when we cut stuff back, just normal. You've got to cut stuff back. Stuff's growing all year here. The right plant's growing all the time. Stop fertilizing it, you may not have as much of an issue. Now, can you stop fertilizing? There's some shrubs that I think are getting that way. I think the Earthkind program, when they talk about roses, or the perennials that are planted up at Myers Park, is going to be no fertilizer. It's going to be compost only. That's a good deal, but it's too much for people. It's like the electronic market. I think they're way ahead of what we can handle, but we can barely handle our smartphone. They're probably years ahead of us on stuff, but I don't know if we can handle it. We got to figure this out. The landscape is going to get to the point where you have native and adapted plants. No, there's no fertilizer, just compost. Texas Pure Compost. Does anybody know what that is?
Yes.
The cities around here take it all in, make it into compost up in Anna, bring it back here in bags or bulk. What did I just say?
Texas Pure.
Texas Pure. It used to be Plano Pure, but I think even Allen probably gives their refuge to it. All the leaves, all the stems, all the trees go over, they chop it up, compost it. Up here in Anna, there's huge place just full of compost, mountains of it, 8 foot high, sitting there, gorgeous, getting ready to be used. You want a sustainable product, local, Texas Pure. You don't have to buy mulch or compost because it's cheap from Florida. They're just chewing up trees down there to send here. You know, go local when you can. Spread out from there. Don't change tomorrow. Don't redo your whole landscape. Work towards it. It's going to take you doing it. The same as if you worry about what you eat, you got to do the work on it. Your doctor don't. The store don't. It's you doing it to find out. So start learning about this palette because this is where it's going to go to. They can come out with drought-tolerant plants, and they do, and they all over the country. When I buy these plants as little liners from a place in Colorado, Oregon, Pennsylvania, New Hampshire, I buy plants, they say, well, it's a new drought-tolerant plant. It can be, but believe me, we're really glad to have Jimmy Turner at the Dallas Arboretum doing what he's doing. That being said, I can't stand Jimmy Turner at the Dallas Arboretum. Because the Dallas Arboretum waters every day to make that place look good for you. And every native plant I've given him, he's killed, and he knows it, he admits it. I can't have native plants, I gotta water too much. That's fine, that's an oasis in Dallas, that Arboretum. I'm gonna change that, but if you wanna enjoy azaleas and other plants, go to the Dallas Arboretum.
But people go there and they think they can do that in their landscape, and they can't.
Well, they can't, you're right. And they find that out, but you know, that's
unless
it.
They're rich.
Unless they're really rich. And yeah, that's a whole other story. But like I said, nobody here is rich enough to have azaleas. If you want to look at it that way. If you're serious about going this way and towards native and adapted plants, if you go in a garden center and you see encore azaleas, turn around and walk out. They're not going to be able to help you because they're talking out of two sides of their mouth. Okay, I hate I said that out loud, but nobody here remember it, so it's fine. And we have some choices at Shades of Green that I don't like, but we're on the road to it. We have 110 varieties of native and adapted perennials every day of the week there. Landscapers are starting to use it because they're starting the customer, you people, are starting to tell your landscaper you want native and adapted plants. Right now, if a landscaper comes over to your house, you say, yeah, I got this shady thing in the back. I just want to put some azaleas, some color. Yes, ma'am. We'll do it. And they'll do it. They'll put in some azaleas. You'll be happy because you'll have some color. The first year, second year, they start going down. And then, you know, all that money's twitched. When I moved to Van Alstine, we were in the backyard digging. And all I'm finding is white plant tags. I'm just finding tons of them. Everything they tried to put in that shady spot. You know, I struggle with shade, dry shade, you all do too. Most of the plants that you can buy ain't the answer. It's a tough thing. It's what we're finding. We have these plants in the front are all shade plants. They're all native, shade, mostly dry shade plants. when you think about your shade and you think about some kind of big shrub, evergreen shrub in there, get that out of your head. You know, there's some that might do that, but for right now, you know, you either got to let the place go normal or you're going to have a whole mix of plants. And the whole thing about a native border or using native plants is a whole mix of plants. Because some of them only bloom for a couple weeks. You want something that blooms all year. What the heck? I just want something that blooms all year. I don't have to worry about. Well, all the like begonia stuff you have to worry about now. These you don't. The house that stands out now, that looks different to you with all the stuff that's flowering, it's not magic. It's these native plants. You cannot buy these plants at Home Depot or Lowe's. And ultimately, that's where we're at. And I hate to say it out loud, but at this point, I can say it out loud. You can buy, I say that, you can buy Salvia greggii, and there's a lot more available there. If you want to turn this way, and you've got a list of native plants, perennials, because it does give you a great color year round, then go to Home Depot first. Pick out the plants they have that are $5.99. If you can buy a plant, if you're smart enough to buy a plant that it looks healthy to you, go to Home Depot and get started that way. When you can't find the thing like Turk's Cap, then go to Puckett's or Shades of Green and let the local ones help you. Honestly, do it that way. Because if it's a big job, you're gonna have to use a lot of money. And if it means a lot to you to go there, know that ultimately those places are gonna make you sick. Because they're selling a lot of plants that people have just bought time after time. And I can't do much about that, how we can sell so many wrong plants for this area. But when I went in the big box, there was a cart of Encore, there was a cart of Hall's Honeysuckle, and a cart of blueberries. Blueberries, they love acid soil. They won't grow in alkaline soil. But in East Texas, where you pick your own blueberry, acid soil, they can grow blueberries there. And in North Texas, where I was talking about, there's Sadler, or some of those little towns got blueberry farms, Pilot Point's starting to grow blueberries. They have these fingers of acid soil coming down there. If you see like evergreen pine trees, possibly the soil is a little more acid. And that works in Euless. Anybody go across to Fort Worth? If you go through, I don't know those towns, Euless, Bedford, one of them, you're driving along like this big row of evergreen pine trees. That's probably acid soil because they're old and doing great. If you plant a Jap Black pine, it'll look good for about 5 years, and then it starts going down. Photinia. Everybody know what Photinia is? The big plant that should be red, but is usually yellow. Chlorotic. Doesn't like alkaline soil. You know, we're learning that the hard way. But quite honestly, I don't think anybody's behind Photinia anymore. I still kind of like it. If it's out in a field where it can grow real big, it's a great-looking plant.
20 years ago.
But it can't be next to your foundation because that plant ultimately gets 10 foot tall. But as the builder put it in there and you've cut it, you can cut it for 5 years till it gets real woody and you lose that battle. You're stressing the plant by cutting it. That's when you get the problems. I got to talk about these plants. These plants are all native to Texas. All these plants will thrive on twice a month watering. Some will want to be in shade, some will want sun. If you have a spot in your yard that's full sun, glaring sun, nothing grows there, a couple of these plants will grow there and they'll thrive. If you got a real shady spot, if you are under a tree and you want to plant something there, if you can't get your shovel in the ground because of the roots, don't plant a plant there. Okay? Don't say, I'm going to bring in more soil and then I'll plant in that. Tree roots will grow up in that soil next year and you'll be in the same spot. You'll waste a lot of money. We have alkaline soil. This is a tough nut state to garden in, and these natives will do better than anything else you can buy. Is that simple enough? Y'all got it? They don't need fertilizer. They don't need an exorbitant amount of water. They don't need a lot of soil prep. What else is the issue that you got that you don't like to garden? Garden now or in the fall when it's cool enough to do it. In the middle of June when you got a week and you ain't going to be out there, I'll guarantee you. Ain't none of you young enough to be out there. If you do enjoy cutting back stuff, you'll be out there because there'll be bees, hummingbirds, butterflies, birds. There'll be livestock in your yard. And you won't know why, except you stop spraying, you stop fertilizing, you got native plants. And your whole life changes at that point. it's just so shocking. And I didn't do this till the last 8 years. You know, I'm still trying to grow hostas too. But yeah, it's just one of those things that just transforms everything. And then when you get home from work, you grab a beer or a soda, and you're out in your yard walking around because something's blooming. You got to cut something back a little bit. You're deadheading that. You're just joyful to be out there. You know, you don't go across the lawn squishing because it watered. You know, you're like, squish, why is my lawn doing so bad? Squish. We go to people's houses, you can't, it's like a neighbor waters all the time. You know, that's all I hear is the neighbor waters all the time. It's never the person I'm in, which can be true. But anyway, here's the plants. We're only going to talk about sun or shade. Will that be easy enough? Because that's the deal. Okay, this is not going to be easy with natives. This is Salvia farinacea. This plant is native in Collin County. It's the little blue flower you see all on the trails. This one is called Henry Duelberg. It's a name variety. I don't have an issue with that. Purist will. But know that this was found by Greg Grant in East Texas at a cemetery. This plant, Henry Duelberg. When plants grow in cemetery and they look good, that's a plant we want. 3 to 4 foot tall, will reseed, sun or shade, twice a week watering, blue flowers all season long. This is truly what it looks like right now. This is golden groundsel. This is native to this area. This is dry shade perennial. Golden groundsel blooms in the spring. That's fine. It does not bloom all year long. Texas gold columbine. Spring yellow flowers, shade, dry or regular soil, will reseed, will spread where it's happy. Native to Texas. We'll take some sun, but love shade. Anybody that's following native plants, they talk about ground cover, frog fruit and horse herb. This is frog fruit. This is native right wherever you're walking. Texas is down there growing. Has white flowers that's in the verbena family, so it attracts tons of butterflies. It's just, don't put a lot of pressure on your plants. They're just plants. Don't put a lot of pressure on them. This is just a native ground cover. Horse herb, two words. I don't know why they call it that. Little yellow flowers, sun or shade, ground cover. You can mix these two. If you want to just put out 6 of 1 and 6 of the other, mix them, put them in there and get them started in some shade. This is Turk's cap. Malva viscus. First one. Turk's cap. This is the red one. Turk's cap, anybody see? Turban, Turk's cap. There's also a pink one that's relatively new and a white one that's quite a weak plant. Stick with the red and the pink. Hummingbirds love this plant. This is native, shade, perennial. Gets 4 to 5 foot both ways. If it's in really deep shade, it'll just scramble along the ground. This plant, if you want to prove Mother Nature wrong and get something growing where it's too shady, try this one. But ultimately, mulch it over. But this is the deepest shade plant that'll be there. Cut it back in the spring, right to the ground. All these plants cut back when you're out there in the spring. Cut them back to the ground. But for us today, dry shade perennial with color, hummingbirds, butterflies, native. Am I hitting it? You in there? You with me? Got all those things? If you're going to tear out your encores, that's one plant you can put in there. Not evergreen, it's okay. There's no law that says it's got to be evergreen. We're not in Houston. We wish we were. Do we? We don't. But wherever there was a lot of evergreens, we wish we were there, but it's not going to happen. This is Texas. Welcome to Texas. Keep it looking like Texas. You're doing your part. Eat barbecue, drink Shiner, these plants. Who could be happier?
I like that.
This is Tradescantia, spider wort. Widow's tears. Why? I don't know. Concord grape, that's this variety. Tradescantia is native in the bar ditches, in the wet bar ditches in Texas. Later on in April, you'll see it blooming blue in the ditches where they haven't mowed. Up about this tall, blue, different colored blue, a little bit of white. This one just has really nice ornamental foliage. It's a little more blue and a really nice flower. But all Tradescantias do fine. This is a shade plant. East side of the house, under trees, shade, spiderwort. At tall, probably 18 inches and probably 18 wide. Let it grow 5 or 6 years. If you want to divide it, you can. Otherwise, it's no other issues. This is Mexican feathergrass, stipa. Has a different name now, but we don't care. We still call it stipa. This is Mexican feather. This is a cool season or spring grass. Gorgeous. Use it in the landscape. Sun or shade, just has to be dry. You got a dry, sunny spot? Perfect. You got a dry, shady spot? Perfect. It's just a grass. It'll come up, look great in the spring. It'll plume out late spring, and then it'll go golden colored. Some would say dormant. It's not dead. Leave it alone. Don't ever cut it. If it reseeds, scrape them out with a rake. Or leave them, depending how you're looking at it. All these plants will work in a big planter. If you say you got something out in your sun patio and you go on vacation and you got to water every day, not with this. If you plant that combo, enjoy it till June 1st and then let her go. It ain't worth keeping it alive because that clay pot and those plants get root bound. You can't water it. Once a day isn't enough. Is it worth it? Nah, if you start using these plants or just change out to some summer loving color, maybe not. Salvia greggii. This has 10 different colors. They all do fine. Red, white, bicolor, everything. Pink. This is blooming now and it'll bloom till Thanksgiving.
How tall does that one get?
That one gets 3 to 4 foot. Cut it back through the year. Don't let it get woody on you. Keep nice green growth and it'll keep blooming. If you let it get old and gnarly, that's cool, but cut them back. It's a 1 gallon plant every 3 or 4 years. If you can't do that, replace it. Talking from a garden center, huh? Nothing to it, just replace it. That's sun first, part shade. If you got a little afternoon shade, try that plant. You're gonna make mistakes. You're gonna make mistakes. I still make mistakes. But these are the way to go when you're talking about, if it thrives in that spot, you got it. If you lose it, move it over to a little sun. Those trees, everything's changing in your landscape. The trees are growing every year. The neighbor's trees are bugging you. Your trees, you know, you can't put a plant there and it's done. So just get something there that thrives, look for it. Okay, those were all, where are you gonna plant them in your yard?
Shade.
All right, and they're all, where they come from?
They're native.
All right, they're all Texas natives, they're all shade. These are all Texas natives, they're all sun first. Now that means put them out full sun, full, hot, blazing sun. Once a month watering, quite honestly. When you plant it, water it real good, check it with your finger, and then see what happens. This is Calilophus, Texas primrose. Texas primrose, this has got buds on it. See this coming? Those are the flowers coming. This is real time. This is where it grows. It grows 8 inches tall and spreads about 3 foot. Almost a ground cover, down over a wall, air with Blackfoot daisy, perfect. Yellow flowers, no insect or disease problems. It's native of Texas, full sun. It's coming to bloom now. It's gonna bloom about 6 weeks and then it's gonna rest. It's okay to rest in Texas when you're a plant or a person. It's okay not to be out in your stupid yard in the middle of July for blooming plants. You ain't out there anyhow. Salvia lucantha, Mexican bush sage. This might be not native of Texas, but anyhow, we're splitting hairs. This is Salvia lucantha, huge plant, blooms all summer long. This is real time, just starting now. Gets 6 foot both ways. It's a shrub. This is a shrub, not evergreen. It's okay. But some years, like this past year, it could have been evergreen. This winter has been very mild by Texas. Hell knows what's going to pay this summer, but this winter was really nice. This is a salvia. Every salvia, almost all our friends, even if they're not native, all have fragrant foliage. Most of the time, rabbits won't bother them. Sometimes they will. Rabbits will eat anything. I can't help you with that. I know we've all lied about it, but there's certain things rabbits eat in McKinney or Allen. They don't eat anyplace else, and there's almost everything in your yard. Especially if you over-fertilize and put on that nice growth, they love that. Far-nerve daisy. If you're all getting to where you're pretty cool with this native stuff and you want to go a little deeper, far-nerve daisy. A little tougher to grow here. It's native to Texas, but native in the hill country in West Texas. So this clay soil, kind of an issue. But if you're growing Blackfoot daisy in a real dry bed, put it out there. This plant is far-nerve daisy. Native, full sun, 12 inches tall, 12 inches across, blooms all year long, but it's got to stay dry. Put it in the driest spot. Wherever your hose reaches, plant it 6 foot past that spot. Blackfoot daisy, probably my favorite. This is a native Texas perennial. It gets 12 to 18 inches tall and 24 inches across, roughly. It starts blooming now and blooms till Thanksgiving or later. It starts blooming now and blooms till Thanksgiving or later. Full sun, dry conditions. Twice a month watering, probably perfect. Less than that, probably will sustain itself on natural rainfall. Put this in a big pot, and you'd be surprised. You won't be watering it, but once a week. A lot of native plants, when you want to water, wait till the next day. Look at them again. You'll know what a dry plant looks like. It's easier to bring a plant back from being dry than being too wet. Once it's too wet, usually gone. Too dry, this may die down, but it'll come back from the roots. Skullcap, pink skullcap, another favorite. True time, this is what it does, but it blooms from April, May. Blooms from May all the way to Thanksgiving. This is Texas skullcap. May not be native here, don't worry about that. It's from Mexico, it's fine, we love Mexican plants. Texas skullcap, pink skullcap. If you want a ground cover, this is it. Grows about 12 inches tall and then spreads like a mound, a gorgeous mound. Almost unthinkable. Anybody that has native plants, when they come out, they look like something out of a magazine. They come out very behaved. They're all just this perfect little mound, and then they bloom. You enjoy them. Something else comes behind it and blooms. This is Salvia greggii. Fragrant. Rabbits don't really like it. That's a greggii, too. This is red. That's pink. There's white, bicolor, tons of them. 3 to 4 foot shrubs. When you plant them, it's going to get 4 to 5. How far do I space them? 4 to 5 foot. It's going to look weird at first. If you want to put some annuals in this year, do it. Let these get bigger. Anybody feel like they could take over the maintenance in the yard again from a company? Okay, I think you can. And the city's going to appreciate it. People in Texas will appreciate it because I think a lot of those issues come from somebody else telling you what to do in your lawn, and you've got to learn what to do. Thank you all. Go home and plant a garden today. Get out in your landscape.